The way we consume and share news today, it is largely rooted in social media outlets, a reason why it's crucial to look at what's being discussed online, from the hottest issues to trends for our daily social media. And we're joined by Erica. Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Friday.
Friday.
Let's jump into some of these buzzwords this morning. A rare Joseon-era map returning home from Japan. It's a long journey. What's the story? Only if this map could talk.
Yes, so this is a really special map, and we'll talk about why this map is so special in just a little bit. But the Cultural Heritage Administration has unveiled the Taedongyeojido, which was previously owned by a Japanese collector. So to give you a bit of context, officials from the Overseas Korean Cultural Heritage Foundation, they flew to Japan to check the condition of this relic, negotiate a deal for its return. Just earlier this month, the Korean government purchased it and brought it back to Korea. For reasons of confidentiality, the price of the purchase has not been disclosed, but it's home at
it's
last.
It's home at last. It was owned by a Japanese collector. That makes more sense. Let's also tell our listeners about the Taedongyeojido, which translates literally to the territorial map of the Great East.
That's right. The Taedongyeojido was created by cartographer and geographer Kim Jong-ho back in 1861 during the Joseon Kingdom. It was republished in 1864 in the form of 22 foldable booklets. The map was really significant for its time because it was one of the first attempts at a comprehensive mapping of the Korean peninsula. It captured all the administrative divisions, all the physical features, and villages of the country in great detail.
So maybe simply put, it was the first modern map of South Korea?
That's right. It was the first modern map of Korea. All the other maps of Korea preceding this one reflected a kind of skewed view that our ancestors had of the world at the time. They believed that the Korean Peninsula and China were at the center of the world. This one shows the Korean Peninsula as it exists. Now, Kim Jong-ho, on foot, traveled to every inch of the Korean Peninsula three times during his lifetime. And he climbed Baekdusan Mountain eight times to create this map. It's quite an achievement, right?
I mean, by foot, every inch of the Korean Peninsula three times in his lifetime. That's already enough. Climbed the Baekdusan Mountain eight times in his life? That's, I mean, okay, I'm a little bit floored. Okay, let's go back to the map itself, the creation. Mm-hmm. Why is this version so special?
So the returned map is a woodblock printed edition produced in 1864. It is colored and it contains handwritten revisions, or kapil in Korean. Mm. It contains all of the geographical information from Dongyeodo, or Atlas of the Eastern State, which features geographical information on Joseon-era Korea, including 1,800 traffic routes, military facilities, names of various locations. And scholars say they have a good reason to believe that Dongyeodo may also have been created by Kim. They're not 100% sure, but they have good reason to believe that it was created by Kim Jong-ho at the time.
Okay, so not necessarily confirmed yet, but they have a good hunch, an educated guess. So what is the key difference between then the Taedongyeojido and the Dongyeodo?
Yeah, so unlike Dongyeodo, Taedongyeojido omits many names of places and territories due to the difficulties, challenges involved in carving woodblocks. The edition returned from Japan recently is the first known example that compensates for the limitations of the woodblock printed Taedongyeojido by transcribing by hand the annotations from Dongyeodo. And this Taedongyeojido edition consists of 23 booklets. So think of each booklet as a piece of a big puzzle, right? There are 22 booklets in total, and one booklet that contains the list of each booklet map. And as scholars say, this Taedonggyojido, this edition is expected to expand the scope of research on Joseon-era geographical information as the first woodblock printed edition with transcribed annotations from the Dongyeodo.
Which, I mean, I know probably to speak of a map of this caliber, oh, how pretty, is not very educated or relevant. But look at the map. Just because they've omitted the names and places because of the difficulties of using these wooden blocks to inscribe them, it's beautiful. I mean, Look at that image we've been streaming. I hope you guys got a glimpse. All right, let's move on to our second buzzword of the day. The Seoul Museum of Art is set to open Korea's first public art archive. This sounds exciting.
Yes, so the Seoul Museum of Art is a network of museums and art-focused bodies that are scattered all throughout Seoul. It's operated by the Seoul City government. Now, the Art Archives, Seoul Museum of Art, is slated to open on April 4th. It is South Korea's first ever public institution that is dedicated to collecting, preserving, and researching historic records and documents that are relevant to the contemporary Korean art scene.
Look at that. Where is the Art Archives located, and can anyone access it?
It's pretty central. It's in the Jongno-gu district in Pyeongchang-dong. The institution brings together some 57,000 archival materials that, officials have been collecting since 2017, which include never-before-released artist notes, drawings, handwritten manuscripts, diaries, correspondences, memos, photographs, films, and books. The writings of art historians, critics, and curators. So it's a pretty expansive collection.
Okay.
The building itself, it was completed last year after 3 years of construction. The building, well, there are three buildings, separate structures in total that make up Art Archives. The main building, which is named Moeumdong, houses exhibition halls. It also has a reference library with over 4,500 art books and a research lab. Visitors can make reservations in advance to browse through more than 20,000 original archived materials. So to answer your question earlier, yes, visitors, anyone can access the archives.
But I don't know if anyone should. 20,000 sounds massive. Yeah. Where do I begin? Okay. I'm hoping, because I mean, it is an exhibition sort of open to the general public. They'll have some guidances, tours, explanations, because just showcasing is probably not enough for someone like me. To mark this grand opening of the Art Archives, the archive is hosting two special exhibitions offering a peek into its collection. Do we have more details on that?
Yeah, so one of the exhibits brings to light the extensive collection of artworks and historic documents accumulated by acclaimed critic, poet, educator, and curator, Chimin. He amassed 161 artworks and nearly 25,000 materials during his lifetime. All of them were donated to the Seoul Museum of Art by his family back in 2019 and 2020. There's another special exhibit, Archive Highlight, Kim Yong-sik, Kim Cha-seok, Im Dong-sik, which is set to present over 50 of the notes, rough sketches kept by these three contemporary creators. You know, they were sort of known for forging their own path, artistic path, against the changing socio-political climate of Korea in the 1970s. And these special exhibits run through until July 30th.
All right, something to check out if you're in the country. And let's move on to our final buzzword of the day. It's to mark his legacy, but there is something somber and sad about this exhibit. Leslie Cheung's life, his works are on display in Hong Kong to mark the 20th anniversary of his passing.
I can't believe it's been 20 years, first of all. The late singer, actor, he was such an icon, during his 26-year-long career. He released over 40 albums, started over 50 films. You know, his popularity reached, outside of Asia, more globally after the release of the film Farewell, My Concubine in 1993. The actor and singer is also famously praised for his openness about his sexual orientation and for becoming a queer icon.
And being fearless in his performances. I mean, if you still look at some of his concerts, I mean, you want to talk about a performer, there you have it. The charisma, the styling, he's fearless, right? So to put it simply, an icon that defined a generation. Let's talk about the tributes that are being held in Hong Kong as they mark the 20th anniversary of his passing.
Well, there's several actually taking place in Hong Kong right now. For example, Olympian City is hosting an event titled Timeless Leslie Encounter. It narrates 20 stories that friends and fans have with Cheung, and the sharing sessions will be held today, March 31st, and it's going to feature some of his good friends and collaborators sharing their stories of their encounters with Leslie Cheung and interacting with the star. His friends will also showcase memorabilia in their collections, and one of them includes the Leslie Cup trophy from the Mahjong competition that he organized back in 1993. There's also a 430-inch TV displaying 20 video clips of the late actor, and there's also a digital mosaic of 3,000 photos taken by his fans that will be available for viewing as well. Reminiscing Leslie Cheung 20th anniversary exhibition is being held at Hong Kong Station. Visitors can see various memorabilia related to the late actor from his friends and fans, illustrations from local artists. There's also a life-sized bust of the late actor at a one-to-one scale that is currently on display until April 6th. And lastly, there's a multimedia tribute to Cheung that is happening over the course of 3 days until tomorrow at the West Kowloon Cultural District. So, you can go online, check out all of these events. There's several more that I haven't mentioned because we're running out of time. But people are really missing him. And that is evident through all of these exhibitions and concerts and cultural events that are taking place.
Clearly, the tribute continues. I just saw a documentary on Leslie Cheung, and new documentaries we're creating, not just to mark the anniversary. So there are many ways you can learn about his life. Thank you so much, Erica. Have a good weekend.
You too.
If you're listening to our program using the podcast service, just a reminder that we do go live Monday through Friday, 7 a.m. Korea Standard Time. So tune in and help us make the show more informative by giving us your input. See you bright and early on Good Morning Seoul.